you for joining us today on Lunch and Learn Live. Today we have a very, very, very special guest, Brian Achey, spelled A-C-H-E-E, and you pronounce it Achey, right?
Correct.
His wife's name is Margot Achey, which is super French, and I don't speak any French, but I like to use a really poor French accent for fun and sound cool.
That was well done.
Did I sound cool?
Yeah.
Awesome. So Brian's a very special guest. He is a veteran of Operation Iraqi Freedom. He has been through a heck of a lot for you and for me and for our way of freedom and to keep the world free and to champion the cause of freedom throughout the world. And just appreciate you immensely. He and I had lunch 2 weeks ago, and you may have seen I posted a couple weeks ago after our lunch just amazing, amazing stuff he's gone through, and the sacrifices that he and his family have made for us are simply something I can't imagine in my relatively easy life. And first of all, thank you, Brian. Thank you.
Thank you for your support.
Definitely, our honor. So, Brian, tell us, we had some amazing conversations, and I only want you to share what you're comfortable sharing about what you've been through. What were some of the biggest challenges of defending freedom in Iraq?
Well, I think you just have to keep in mind the mission going in. I mean, we had were charged with obviously going in and defending our country and our ways to the enemy. Specifically, my mission, you know, I was in the Ranger community, so close with and kill the enemy was what we were trained to do. You go out there, but you're also asked to intermingle with the population and the Iraqi or Afghanistan. I served in both regions to kind of integrate with their military and show them the ways to be able to perform the same duties. So.
That's awesome. And you encountered some very, very challenging physically, mentally, and emotionally times, correct?
Correct, yes.
So you, one of the things that Brian told me is you had an encounter with three different IEDs, correct?
Correct.
Tell us about those, if you would.
First two were in Iraq, same deployment. Dismounted IED was the first one I encountered. I was about 25, 30 feet away from the blast itself. It was a dismounted, meant for troops on the ground. So it wasn't as large as a vehicle would encounter.
Mm-hmm.
Very minor injuries, concussion, fragment from, you know, debris, and just twisted my knee up a little bit.
Minor. Okay.
Worst of that would be the concussion.
Yeah.
Second one in Iraq was vehicle-borne IED. Fairly larger IED. It was about 100 pounds of explosives. We were in a Humvee. They're up armored, so they're meant to take a blast.
Right.
Disabled our vehicle, burned to my lower leg, superficial.
Okay, so let me pause you right there. Disabled the vehicle, there's more details to it than that. Explain what you mean by disabled, what happened to the engine compartment, and where the engine landed.
That was the Afghanistan.
Okay, sorry, okay, all right.
This one was, took off a portion of the trunk of the vehicle and the rear driver's side tire, completely gone.
Wow.
About 30 feet away, and minor injuries, another head injury, minor burn in my leg, and a pretty significant firefight to follow.
Wow.
So we were kind of there for a while.
You had a lot of firefights, from what I heard.
Yeah. Iraq and Afghanistan, completely different theaters, depending on where you are. Iraq, we had a lot more of an urban fight, mm-hmm. So we were in a lot of our firefights were within the community, you know, heavily populated. So, you know, you have to be mindful of that.
Sure.
Afghanistan fight was, you know, mountainous, rural areas.
Right. So. I understand that at times it can be very difficult to discern the enemy from the people we're trying to free. Right. The appearance, obviously, genetically, they're very similar. They look very similar. Their attitudes can be radically different from one another, correct?
Correct.
Most of the Iraqi people are very peace-loving, welcoming of the soldiers and all the the people trying to free them, right?
Yeah.
But radically different ideals from the people who were the enemy, correct?
Correct. Yeah, there was a... Yeah, I mean, ultimately, they want their way of life to be, you know, as free as we are here.
Right.
You know, and but unfortunately, in that region of the world, there's a lot of oppression, and so they're forced to do things normally that they don't want to do, and live in a region that is overwhelmed by a radical ideology.
Right.
You know, that we see running rampant all over the world now.
Right. Did you always feel sort of, what's the word, emotionally engaged and 100% like you were doing the right thing over there?
Definitely.
That's good.
Yeah, I always, definitely have a lot of pride for our country and our way of life and the freedoms that we have. And, I mean, that's why I did what I did. But, you know, going over there, they want the same thing.
Right.
You know, so... being able to do what we could to allow that to be their way of life as well is something that we take personally over there.
That's fantastic. And just the fact that I can come here and do my work and all of us can live in this great state, in this great country, and do the things that we do simply because of people like you is the best we can do is ever say just thank you. So the third... IED. That's the one I knew. I'd sort of hybridized two stories, I think. So tell us about the third.
So the third, Afghanistan theater, heavily up armored vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
Those things were built to take a blast. I was a platoon sergeant at the time, so I was, you know, had about 37 soldiers that I had out there. I was traveling rear in the formation. Vehicle took a blast. We was supposed to be secured for us. We put a little too much trust in our counterparts, the Afghanis out there, to hold down a certain area. I won't go into all that. We blew past an area that was a known IED hotspot,
yeah.
Thinking that it was secured. We secured it on the way out. Didn't identify the tails of the area that were kind of showing signs of enemy activity. You know, a lot of population wasn't in and around this area, but so we failed to identify that. So the vehicle was hit by about a 200-pound IED, tossed it like a Tonka truck on the playground. Had significant injuries to that one. Nothing, you know, I mean, I'm here, so I'm thankful.
Yeah, right.
Worst being a head injury, concussion that left me pretty dazed and confused for a good couple days. Vision was impaired slightly for a couple weeks. Back injury. Some debris injury to my lower abdomen, dislocated shoulder, lower back injury, and those were probably the worst of the injuries.
Oh my gosh. So going through something like that obviously can not only scar you physically, but emotionally as well.
Yeah.
I can't even begin to imagine. So you finished your deployment, you were retired, and you finished your last deployment, and you came back to the States, and I understand that was hard to reintegrate, correct?
Yeah, it was definitely hard. I feel like the IED and continuing the deployment, you know, I recovered for about a month and a half out there.
Mm-hmm.
Was very stubborn and had a good chain of command that wanted me out there.
Yeah.
And so during my recovery, you know, I fought to stay out. They fought to keep me there. I was able to pass their tests. But I think the head injury in itself, and then just the, feeling so vulnerable, you know, I think it really had an impact on me that, you know, that could have been it.
Yeah.
And, you know, I felt really threatened. So that really did something to me psychologically.
Yeah.
Made me a better soldier, So I was more meticulous in my planning and
right.
aggressive towards the enemy.
Right.
But I didn't want to be caught up in that again.
Okay.
And so I also lived with that fear.
Right.
And that really, I mean, it kind of ripped me apart.
Okay.
When I was out there, especially
yeah.
when I came home.
Gosh. So that, you had Margo, of course. You were married that entire time.
Correct.
And how many of your kids were born at that time? He has 4 kids.
Correct.
Age 16 down to 9. 17 down to 9.
Yep.
And so what was the birth order? Who was born during this time, most of this time?
Well, in Afghanistan, my last deployment, they were all...
Wow.
Yeah, we had them all. That was in 2012. I came home in 2013 from that deployment.
Okay.
So yeah, they were all here with Margo. She was holding down the fort, and she does really well. And,
she's an amazing person. They both are. They all are. And I can't imagine what that must have been like for her. There's that old song, "War is Hell on the Home Front," too.
Oh, that is, to say the least.
Yeah. So you've reintegrated now. Every time I see you, you have a shirt that's about supporting the military. So you come out, you've been through hell, for lack of a better phrase, but if anything is hell on earth, I imagine a lot of what you experience is that. And now you come back, and most of what you talk about and most of what you do is about serving veterans.
Mm.
So one of the things that I know a lot of our listeners are aware of is that, am I right, that approximately 23 service members take their own lives every single day, 22, 23?
Yeah.
Is that right?
That's the average right now, yeah.
Every single day take their own lives, more than die in actual combat, from what I've understood, correct? So I imagine you have a strong feeling about that, and I've talked to you a little bit about it.
I do. You know, having gone through what I've gone through and the experiences, you know, everybody within the veteran community has their own. Has their own story to tell, but we all, you know, suffer from, you know, what war is and what that does to you, you know, mentally, physically, and, you know, and a lot of times you don't have the time to come home and decompress the way you should, and so I think that kind of drives the mentality of coming home and not having that, you know, that out tempo that you had in the military,
okay.
and you kind of get thrown to the wayside. You know, in a lot of ways, I had 4 months from the time that I was told that I was no longer suitable for the military. You know, I was indefinite at 15 years,
yeah.
Going to do 20 plus.
Right.
But I was told, had 4 months. You know, hey, medical board, you're no longer fit for duty.
Wow.
I didn't know anything else. You know, so I think, mm-hmm. you know, it really did a number on me. Mentally and physically, you know, I didn't really have a plan. I didn't know what to do, and I had a family to support, so we throw
right.
all those together. But a lot of veterans go through that, and you know, we see it all over. It's
yeah.
somewhat of a broken system.
Yeah.
And so, I like to represent any foundation I can, and any
Great.
Anybody that's promoting health and wellness, you know, especially within the veteran community. But
yeah.
I mean, you have a good program here, taking
yeah.
this in and really, it's helped me tremendously. So.
Good. Well, thank you. So what's Mission 22?
It's they're an outdoors outfit. So
okay.
their goal is to get veterans out, put them in a, you know, we all, again, all walks of life. But one thing we have in common is going out. You know, when you're in the military, you always have that field time. You always have the time to connect with nature and be out.
Yeah.
And that's kind of their focus, is to bring awareness to veteran suicide. But getting these veterans out from, you know, their day to days and the things that they, you know, that they struggle with, and just getting them back out in nature and kind of finding themselves through that.
Yeah, that's awesome. So there are a lot of organizations. What are the main ones you'd say? So if we were to say, all right, I want to lend support, we feel for you. Sometimes I know, as regular citizens who've been babied our whole lives, including me, we don't know how to help. And we hear good things about different organizations. If you were to pick the top 3 organizations that you know what they do and you support them, who would you say?
Top 3. Well, I'll give 2 for, Team Red, White, and Blue.
Okay.
Big advocate for them. We don't have one here locally, but
okay.
Maybe here in the future. Team Rubicon. Mission 22. They're all organized around getting veterans out and bringing them together. You know, veterans thrive together, I think. We all kind of have this way about us. And then just one more for medical. Look into Operation Mend.
Okay.
Great program through UCLA.
Awesome. So go Bruins! Right. So Team Red, White, and Blue, Team Rubicon,
yes.
Mission 22, and Operation Mend through UCLA.
Correct.
Okay, good. More good stuff coming out of UCLA. That's where I went to school, so good. So what are, coming back, having some very challenging times, you alluded to this, and we talked some about this a couple weeks ago. What are some of your key strategies? Because you're an amazingly well-adjusted person now. You're very loving toward people in general, loving toward your wife. When we sat down at lunch, he didn't take the security spot, which is watching the front door, which is with my family, it's always what I do. I was blown away. That means you're pretty well-adjusted to me. So the security spot is you always have to be able to watch the front door and never back to a window, back to a wall where you can secure the area. I was blown away. That was a good sign to me. So what are some of the keys you've done to do that?
Well, I'm definitely taking key points from, you know, that Operation Mend program. They gave me a lot of tools to put in the toolbox, you
Beautiful.
Know, to be able to regulate stress, be mindful of your surroundings, which veterans are very keen with and
sure.
oriented towards. But, you know, you also have to, you can't let that rule you. And that's what it ends up doing.
Right.
So although I'm, you know, I have my moments, you know, it depends on the environment I'm in.
Okay.
But, you know, in that environment, I felt comfortable enough to do it. But doing things, you know, you got to push the boundaries, you know, and to become the person you were before.
Mm-hmm.
And what I mean by that is, you know, the stressors that you have, at, you know, at, that a veteran has that make you hypervigilant, you know, and really kind of rule your way of life after, you know, certain experiences and kind of PTSD related mentality, driven mentality, you know, you have to fight the urge to always be on guard. I mean, stress is a killer, you know, and
Absolutely.
That's what that leads to, you know, that hypervigilance, that always be, you know, on, you know, and super aware of your surroundings, alert, you know, great way to be, but, you know, you have to be able to let go a little bit and feel comfortable where you are, you know.
Like Dave Grossman's color conditions. Do you guys use that language? Yeah. Not condition red all the time, of course, but condition orange. I don't remember the color assignments exactly, but anyway, we like orange at Rhino. But so the Operation Mend, you mentioned your relationship to God, that you developed a relationship with God since you came back, and how has that helped?
Well, it's been my number one thing in my life. Complete, you know, I wouldn't say a 180, but any, you know, a lot of the mental healing that I think that I've had, you know, after every deployment, you know, some guys go through counseling, some guys are told to go through counseling. I never went through counseling until my last deployment where I came home, you know, with the injuries that ultimately put me out of the Army. But even through all the counseling, all the healing that, you know, that I went through, even, you know, physically, you know, kind of meditation and things of that nature, you know, nothing has helped me more than, you know, a lot of the Eastern medicine mentality, you know, nothing wrong with that. There was a lot of good in that, but, you know, the mentality of clearing your mind and letting go of, you know, let the heart just flow, you know, I mean,
right.
you know, the heart is sinful, you know, so, you know, you're definitely prone to live the way you want to live and do the things you want to do. The flesh drives that, you know, and that's our natural way.
Right.
But with, you know, with Christ in my life, I keep focused on, you know, that as sinful as I am, I'm forgiven of those sins. So, you know, it's helped me mentally let go of a lot of things that I held on to and really let rule my way and just let go.
That is awesome.
Let the Lord take the driver's seat, you know.
Free indeed.
Yeah.
That is awesome. Good. And then we were honored to have you show up at our doorstep here through a mutual referral, some amazing people who said you could use some help. Mm-hmm. And so we said, good, we'll send them in. And, And I've just really enjoyed getting to know you and Margot, and it's been a pleasure. So tell us about that experience.
Sorry, you have to say that again.
Just coming in here, we've loved taking care of you. How's that experience been?
It's been great.
Good.
Sorry, I lost my train of thought.
Not a problem. You're allowed.
Surprised I lasted this long. I was definitely thankful that you were willing to take us on. Wes and Julie, shout out.
Hi guys.
So, definitely veteran friendly, and I was, I'm hesitant. I was always hesitant with going this route.
Yeah.
Just for fear of the unknown, and me thinking that I could do it myself.
Uh-huh.
But we saw how far that got me, nowhere fast. And so I was definitely thankful that you took us on. And since then, I've had a lot of relief in things that, my daily physical struggles have been relieved. I don't want to throw percentages out there because you won't know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I always have, from the head injury, I have a lot of residual and daily headaches that sometimes drive to the point of almost migraines. Those have been relieved. Lower back pain relief. My shoulder from the dislocation has always given me problems. I have a lot more mobility.
Awesome.
Which is interesting because, again, I was skeptical, coming in with the, how much the, just out of lack of knowledge, much the, the spine plays in your overall health and wellness.
Uh-huh.
I'm sold now.
Awesome. Yeah. Well, I'm glad. Well, it's been an honor taking care of you and knowing you, and this interview has been an absolute honor. And we're going to get you doing some rhino workouts soon. We're figuring that out because it's going to be awesome. So you and I will have to go head-to-head on some of those and beat each other up a little. It should be fun.
Sure.
Well, it's been a true honor. You are an amazing person, husband, man of God, and servant of our country. And just the best I guess we can do is just say thank you so much, because if it weren't for you and people like you, we wouldn't be able to get to live in this amazing free country that I still believe is the absolute greatest in the world. And thank you. God bless you. Appreciate you, Brian.
Thank you for your support.
Yeah, man. Thank you. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you tomorrow.